So once again, we're going to look at strategic decision making. Now, let's look at the different options and choices available for both Boeing and Airbus. When we look at the horizontal side, it's Boeing, when Boeing chooses to develop or not develop. Then we look at the vertical side, we look at Airbus, and Airbus chooses to develop or not develop. And if Boeing decides to develop, they have a high risk. If Boeing decides to develop and Airbus decides to develop, Boeing will have a high risk and Airbus will have an okay risk. And if Boeing decides to develop, Airbus decides not to develop, Boeing will have some risk, Airbus will have a loss, and so on and so forth. So we're going to analyze, I'm going to show you how to analyze this, and then we can look at what's the decision that will be made. Let's look at what happens if Boeing develops first. So if Boeing develops, Airbus has two choices. Airbus develops, or Airbus doesn't develop. So if we're going to look at Airbus's outcome, we only look at this side, okay risk versus loss. Because Boeing is going to develop, if Boeing chooses to develop no matter what, then you don't care about these two outcomes of Boeing, right? We just want to see if Boeing develops, what will Airbus do? So if I give you two choices, if you have two actions, the first outcome is okay risk and the second outcome is a loss, which action is better for you? Naturally, the better action will be okay risk, because okay risk means you have some loss, but loss is a definite loss. So if Boeing develops, Airbus will choose to develop as well. Now, what if Airbus does not develop at all? If Boeing doesn't develop at all, what will Airbus do? So Airbus will also choose between an okay risk versus a loss. If Boeing doesn't develop, there's an okay risk by Airbus if Airbus develops, because there's a lot of money being put into R&D. So you have a risk there. And if they succeed, they will be the market leader. So that trade-off is an okay risk. If they don't develop and Airbus doesn't develop, it's status quo, where Boeing will still continue making a lot of money and being the market leader, and Airbus is going to lose out no matter what. So if you're going to choose between okay risk and a loss, Airbus will choose an okay risk, which is to develop. Now, we move on to looking at Boeing's actions. So let's say Airbus will choose to develop no matter what. What will Boeing do in return? Now, Boeing will either choose to develop where they have a high risk, or they choose not to develop and have a loss. If Boeing develops and Airbus develops, they have a high risk. Because if Boeing develops, then they have to pump R&D money, which is a loss. And then also, if it doesn't succeed, it's an even worse loss. If it succeeds, then they now have to compete the Super Jumbo Jets market share with Airbus. As compared to right now, or as compared to that situation before, where they're already the market leader with Boeing 777. And if they don't develop, but Airbus develops, if Airbus succeeds, they will have a loss. And if you compare these options, it's better for Airbus to not develop, and because if Airbus doesn't succeed when they develop, Boeing is still going to win. So the chances, the probability of, or the trade-off, it's better for Boeing to not develop. And what if Airbus decides not to develop? Then Boeing will either have some risk if they develop, or they'll have profits if they don't develop. So if Airbus decides not to develop, and Boeing decides to go and develop, it's like you've put a lot of money into R&D. If it succeeds, it's good for you. You get a lot of rewards. If it doesn't succeed, then you're back to square one, and you still get a lot of rewards. So it's some risk associated, because if you fail, you lose quite a bit in R&D. And if Airbus doesn't develop and Boeing doesn't develop, it's status quo, where Airbus is the market leader anyway, so they'll continue to get profits. And so if given that decision, Airbus will choose to not develop and continue getting profits. So what does this mean? We've looked at each of the specific actions and then analyzed their decision making. Now we want to analyze the behaviors and outcomes. So based on whatever that we did just now, if Boeing decides to develop and Boeing decides not to develop, you realize that Airbus will choose to develop no matter what. And if Airbus chooses to develop or Airbus chooses not to develop based on the risk and losses, or the probable risks and losses, Boeing decides not to develop no matter what. And you realize that the circles that I made coincide in one quadrant, which is Boeing decides not to develop and Airbus decides to develop. And this is something that they will do no matter what, because Boeing develops or not develop, Airbus doesn't change its decision. Airbus is going to develop. If Airbus develops or doesn't develop, Boeing is not going to change its decision. It's just going to not develop. So this is a steady state. Sometimes we call it steady state, in the more academic term or the more economic term, we call it a Nash equilibrium. A Nash equilibrium is a state where no one wants to deviate, no one wants to change. So the circles coincide with each other, and you realize that Airbus will develop and Boeing will not develop. What's the link? Remember I told you that the outcome is that Airbus decides to delay because Airbus doesn't want to develop, and Boeing decides to, okay, we're just going to develop, we're not going to develop the super jumbo jet because it's quite expensive for now, but let's you know, develop a smaller plane, which is A330XX. And we can, when we are analyzing we look at all the different decisions to analyze the outcomes and behaviors, we realize that they really coincide. This chart and this outcome of this game theory analysis really coincides with what exists or what happens in real life. So that's the quick example of Boeing versus Airbus and how game theory comes into play, because we can use game theory to analyze and understand how they come up to this, how they come to this decision. And the link with token economics, once again, game theory is very linked to token ecosystems and token economics, because we want to analyze and understand how people behave, how people have the different actions, and then ultimately, if possible, we want to find the Nash equilibrium, which is the steady state where people don't move. And we can always influence that with the different mechanisms, incentives, or governance to change them. So if you want to know more information about or more details, you can check out either the 101 class that's coming out in person in Singapore, or you can check out the 201 course. I will link both of the videos below so you can have an understanding of what to expect in both of them. And you can either join me in person in Singapore, or you can sign up for the course online for the 201 class. Well, until then, I'll see you next time. Bye.